Academy team for their support and continuous improvement they are offering to our career. I would like also to thank Dr. Saad Mahdi for his support, and thank you, Dr. Samir Al-Ansari, for your nice presentation. My topic will be advanced hemodynamic monitoring in cardiac surgery. We all know that hemodynamic monitoring and adequate volume therapy and the use of positive inotropes and vasopressors are the basis of perioperative care in cardiothoracic anaesthesia and intensive care. Guidelines many years ago was published in Germany, classifying the cardiac surgery and intensive care monitoring into basic and advanced. In this basic monitoring algorithm, we will see that ECG and the pulse oximeter and capnography and invasive blood pressure and central venous pressure and temperature measurement, fluid balance hourly and every 4 hours. After stabilization, ABG on ICU on admission, central venous line oxygen saturation are the basic monitors that every cardiac surgical patient should have in the operating room and the intensive care. Then the same guidelines defined the indications for advanced hemodynamic monitoring. It was said that in coronary artery bypass grafting, if I have hemodynamic instability with ST segment elevation, I should use transesophageal echo in intubated patients or transthoracic echo in non-intubated patients and 12 lead ECG with central line mixed oxygen saturation monitoring. But if I have low cardiac output syndrome pre or post operatively, or I have a very high risk surgical patient, I need transesophageal echo in intubated patients, transthoracic echo in extubated patients, central venous oxygen saturation, and added pulse contour analysis and pulmonary artery catheter, especially in right heart failure cases. Also, if I have a valvular defect plus coronary heart disease, so I have a combined coronary and valve surgery, or I'm having a patient with pulmonary hypertension, severe pulmonary hypertension, or I'm having a right side heart failure, transesophageal, transthoracic, and pulmonary artery catheter with continuous mixed venous oxygen saturation. So, what are our hemodynamic goals for critical cardiac surgical patients? Our hemodynamic goals are central venous oxygen saturation more than 70%, or mixed venous oxygen saturation more than 65%, mean arterial blood pressure more than 65 millimeter mercury, which varies from person to person according to the perfusion of each patient and original blood pressure. Cardiac index more than 2 liters per minute per square meter. CVB from 8 to 12 millimeter mercury. Left ventricular end-diastolic area 6 to 9 square centimeter per square meter. It is indexed. Intrathoracic blood volume index 800 to 1000. Global end-diastolic volume index 600 to 800 milliliters per square meter, pulmonary artery occlusion pressure from 12 to 15 millimeter mercury, and a diuresis more than 0.5 milliliter per kg per hour. We will revise all the hemodynamic goals, but our advanced hemodynamic monitoring tools to achieve those goals are echocardiography. The gold standard is transthoracic. If I'm having an intubated patient with good view, in the intensive care, I can use also the transthoracic, but if I have intubated patient in the OR or intubated patient with difficult transthoracic window, I will use the transesophageal. The second monitor is the pulmonary artery catheter, and the third group of monitors are the pulse contour analysis devices, which I am going to discuss rapidly. Echocardiography, as we all know, that it offers additional hemodynamic data over any advanced monitor. It can give you a lot of hemodynamic and anatomical and pathological data. It better is a better guiding for volume and inotrope therapy. It is a better guide for surgical decisions. It is a rapid and easy to perform, especially the transthoracic one. However, it is expensive. It's an expensive machine, an expensive transesophageal echo probe. It is not continuous, and this is a major difference between transthoracic or transesophageal echocardiography from the pulmonary artery catheter. However, continuous forms of transesophageal echo are evolving. Echo is operator dependent and needs experience and training. And transesophageal echo has its own complications. We have esophageal. We can have an esophageal perforation. We can have a trauma to the airway. We can have trauma to the esophagus. We may have gastric upset. So it has also its own complication. It is not without complication technique, but echocardiography is our first line. It's the first line examination. It confirms the diagnosis. It's confirming that the, my hemodynamic problem is cardiac in origin. And it denotes what is the etiology. It is left-sided failure or right-sided failure. I can apply, as you see downstairs, pulse with Doppler across the aortic valve and LVOT, and having the Doppler blood flow across the aortic valve. Cardiac cycle. It's a very easy and practical method of evaluating the contractility. Low VTI equals low ejection fraction and low fractional area change and low fracture shortening. Echo may not need measurement. I can detect hypocontractility by eyeballing. So what I am seeing is ejection fraction less than 20 to 25 without any measurement. However, I have many methods of measurement, and I'm going to focus on specific points of measurements which are practical to use in the perioperative period. One important measure of contractility that is evolving and easily used intraoperative is the left ventricular outflow tract, VTI. I applied the Doppler across the left ventricular outflow tract, and I'm having a curve, Doppler flow across the VTI. I get the height of this curve and trace this curve to have the velocity time integral. A velocity time integral less than 10 centimeter, it is the average distance a blood cell is ejected during one cardiac cycle. So it's in centimeter. So LVOT VTI less than 10, it denotes that this is a failing ventricle, failing left ventricle, and requires urgent mechanical circulatory support. Also, I can find with transesophageal and transthoracic echo missed data or new data that evolved in the patient, like newly developed ischemic mitral regurge or newly developed segmental wall motion. This is a transgastric midpapillary showing a kissing signs denoting hypovolemia, but with monitoring of the volume, I am monitoring the contractility of the left ventricle, and this is a good contractility, although it's an empty ventricle. Also, I can monitor the segmental wall motion. I'm monitoring now the anterior wall of the left ventricle, the inferior wall of the left ventricle, the lateral wall of the left ventricle, area of the LED, area of the PDA, area of the circumflex. So I'm monitoring the function and the coronary supply and the volume from one image, and I can trace the endocardial border to get left ventricular in the diastolic area and in systolic area, and can have a monitor of contractility with the fractional area change. Also, I can detect unexpected shunts in persistent hypoxemia or persistent hemodynamic instability, and also detection of this shunts can improve the outcome of patient markedly. I can have also measurements. I'm just having a rapid review of what data can I get from echo, but data obtained from echocardiography cannot be summarized in a simple presentation. It's a very large number of data I can have and very large number of information. So I'm just focusing on the rapidly on the most common use. I can trace the left ventricular in diastolic and in systolic area and have the fractional area change, which is normally more than 50%, the monitor of contractility. I can trace by M mode left ventricle in systolic and in diastolic diameter and to have the fractional shortening, which is a good monitor of contractility. I can have trace the endocardial border for the in the four chamber view and the two chamber view to have the end systolic volume and end diastolic volume and to obtain the stroke volume and the ejection fraction, which is also a very commonly used monitor of contractility. I can measure the cardiac output by tracing the aortic valve, tracing the triangularly opened aortic valve and applying Doppler across the aortic valve to have Doppler flow across the aortic valve. By tracing it, I can have velocity time in fibril, and as we all know, heart rate, cardiac output equals heart rate times stroke volume, and stroke volume equal cross-sectional area of the aortic valve times VTI across the aortic valve. Also, I can assess the diastolic function of the heart by applying Doppler across the mitral valve and to have the E and A waves of the transmitral Doppler. It denotes impaired relaxation or pseudonormalization or restricted filling pattern. Then I can apply tissue Doppler at the mitral annulus to have the E prime and A prime. If I have E prime and A prime, by making a ratio of the E over E prime, E of the transmitral Doppler over the E of that tissue Doppler across the mitral annulus, I can have an E to E prime ratio, which is significant to diagnose high filling pressure in this ventricle. So the ratio here is 0.85 over 0.1. The ratio is 8.5. Normally, the ratio is less than 8 in normal filling pressure. It's if it is more than 14, it denotes a high filling pressure in this atrium and high pulmonary capillary wedge pressure is expected in this situation. So, echo is rich and echo is our first line now. And the transthoracic, if applicable, is very nice. If you cannot have a good image, you can use a transesophageal echocardiography. And transesophageal echocardiography can give you a lot of information. So this is our first line for hemodynamic, advanced hemodynamic monitoring. The second line is the pulmonary artery catheter, and the intensivists are saying that it is obsolete and it is not used. But I have a different opinion, and many of cardiac anesthetists have this a different opinion. Pulmonary artery catheter is use is decreasing, but cannot be replaced until now. It is the gold standard for cardiac output measurement. It is the gold standard for continuous monitoring of critically ill patients. It is very, very valuable in patients with right-sided heart failure and severe pulmonary hypertension. Without the assistance of pulmonary artery catheter, you will lose a lot of those patients because you cannot optimize the volume and the inotropy in such patients. As Professor Samir Ansari discussed, how to insert a route of insertion of this pulmonary artery catheter through the right internal jugular, and it's the easiest route. And insert through a sheath into the right atrium. Here I'm having the right atrial and monitoring the pressure. So this is right atrial pressure. Then I go to the right ventricle. I'm having a systole and very low diastole, nearly zero. And so denoting right ventricle. Then with inflation of the balloon, I go to the pulmonary artery. It floats with blood flow into the pulmonary artery, making a systole and diastole. It's about 25 over 10. And then I go to the pulmonary wedge pressure, which denotes it's a pulmonary capillary wedge pressure, which denotes the left atrial pressure. And usually it is 10 to 12. So this is a pathway. It can monitor, can insert it guided by the pressure tracing, or can be inserted guided by transesophageal echocardiography, or can be inserted guided by fluoroscopy. Choose what is available in your center, but it can be inserted easily in most of the cases. What the data I can have from pulmonary artery catheter, I can have the cardiac output and cardiac index, stroke volume and stroke volume index. I can have main arterial pressure. I can have systemic vascular resistance and systemic vascular resistance index. I can have the pulmonary vascular resistance and pulmonary vascular resistance index, left ventricular stroke stroke work index and right ventricular stroke work index, oxygen delivery and oxygen consumption, oxygen extraction ratio. These are the oxygenation dynamics and oxygen parameters, which are very variable in pulmonary artery catheter. It is a gold standard. We get a continuous useful hemodynamic data during surgery and post-operative, but it has its own complications, which limited its use. Complications include arrhythmia, especially with insertion or maybe with prolonged stay. Infection, like any line, catheter-related infection, pulmonary artery rupture and severe pulmonary hypertension or severe trauma. It may cause valve injury in few cases, knotting and thrombosis, embolism, technical errors, thermistor malfunction, clotting, coiling with the catheter. Misinterpretation of the data is another risk, especially in junior colleagues. However, I inserted the pulmonary artery catheter for 10 years. I did not find a major complication. The most common complication that happened with me is misinsertion. It's good. Sometimes it cannot insert it into the pulmonary artery, especially with tricuspid regurg, or sometimes it's directed toward the inferior vena cava and doesn't go to the pulmonary artery. This is the most common complication I have seen. And the other complication, maybe misinterpretation of data, sometimes that may happen. However, it is still a very valuable tool in cardiac surgery, especially in right and left-sided heart failure, especially with complex procedure, including CABG and valve surgery with pulmonary hypertension. Let us go to the third mode of advanced hemodynamic monitors. It's a pulse control devices, calibrated like the Pico and Ledico, and uncalibrated like the flow track. And non-invasive like bioimpedance cardiometry, for example. I will take the Pico as a start. The calibrated devices are transpulmonary thermodilution devices, include the Pico monitor. What data I can have from the Pico is cardiac output, global end-diastolic volume, global ejection fraction, intrathoracic blood volume, extravascular lung water, pulmonary vascular permeability index. Pico is very valuable for assessing permeability of the lung capillary membrane and extravascular lung water, also with the contractility and preload. However, accuracy of Pico may be affected by vascular compliance, use of large doses of vasopressor, aortic impedance, air bubbles in the system, clotting of the catheter, valvular regurgitation, which is a major issue because these are critically ill patients who need hemodynamic monitors. So my hemodynamic monitor will not be accurate in this situation. Aortic aneurysm, significant arrhythmias, which are very common in cardiac surgery, and rapidly changing temperature. Many validation studies was done for Pico with pulmonary artery catheter, and it was fine with the exception of off-pump coronary artery bypass grafting. Here is the Pico system where I insert a central line and I insert a femoral arterial line. Then I connect the central line with the femoral line through a temperature interface cable. I inject saline, cold saline through the central line. I sense the change in temperature through the femoral line through this cable. So it's an idea similar to that of pulmonary artery catheter on a larger scale. Then I have the transducer, which is connected to the monitor. So I have a central and femoral artery are main components of the PICO system. What data can I have from PICO? The valuable data of pulmonary vascular permeability index and the extravascular lung water. These are very specific for PICO and are very advantageous in the PICO system. So I can detect increased intravascular lung water, normally less than 10 milliliters per kg. It increases in case of hydrostatic pulmonary edema and ARDS. The pulmonary vascular permeability index differentiates between hydrostatic pulmonary edema and ARDS. So it's very valuable for assessment of lung water. Also detect cardiac output by pulse contour analysis, stroke volume, pulse pressure variation. We can detect cardiac function index and global ejection fraction. It's an estimate of the global function of the heart, normally 25 to 35%. Cardiac output measured by transpulmonary thermodilution, which is an intermittent, not continuous, like that measured by pulse contour analysis. Global end-diastolic volume, which is volume of blood in the four chambers of the heart. It's an estimate of the heart volume and the estimate of the volume status of the patient and index of the preload. Also, combined with the lung or the pulmonary vascular permeability and extravascular lung water, I can define cardiac from non-cardiac pulmonary edema or congestion. The second system is the LIDCO, which is lithium dilution cardiac output. It combines pulse contour analysis with the lithium indicator dilution for continuous monitoring of stroke volume variation. Was validated against pulmonary artery catheter, but also it's affected in valvular diseases and aortic regurgitation, aortic reconstruction with the use of intra-aortic balloon, damped arterial line, severe peripheral vasoconstriction, arrhythmias, and intra and extra cardiac chunks. Which requires regular calibration. Its use in cardiac surgery is much less than PICO system. Uncalibrated devices like the flow track system, quite popular in cardiac surgery. It's an easy assessment of the hemodynamic status of the patient. It does not need external calibration. It is operator independent, easy to use. The software analyzes the arterial pressure waveform and uses this analysis with the patient-specific demographic data, height and weight, to calculate the cardiac output and stroke volume variation. We found a good agreement between flow track and pulmonary artery catheter in patients undergoing OPCAB, and accuracy is affected in altered vascular tone and problem with arterial waveform. Here's a demonstration of what flow track can give you: cardiac output and cardiac index, stroke volume and stroke volume variation, a systemic vascular resistance, a systemic vascular resistance index, and some types you can put a fiber optic filament to detect the central line venous oxygen saturation, which adds to the hemodynamic data of the flow track. However, these pulse contour analysis devices are very, very affected by arterial waveform. And if I'm having a severe vasodilatation or severe vasoconstriction, I will have a major problem in analysis of hemodynamic variables. Also, it's affected by valvular regurgitation, especially the LIDCO system and the PICO system. And also, it has a major problem when I use a mechanical circulatory support device. And this is an important issue because mechanical circulatory support devices are increasingly used in cardiac surgery and are the future of cardiac surgery. I think there are more studies are needed in this area to define the role of such pulse contour analysis in such devices. However, the gold standard in patients on mechanical circulatory support are the echo and the pulmonary artery catheter, which is very useful in such situation. A study published in 2016 by the Society of Cardiovascular Anaesthesiologists found that pulmonary artery was used by 68.2 responded for cardiac anesthesia in more than 70% of time, and it was usually associated with the use of transesophageal echocardiography. However, from the commercial angle, there is a negative annual growth of 2% in the sales of pulmonary artery catheter, while a 15% positive growth for the sale of new cardiac output monitoring devices. Let us discuss algorithms for management of left-sided and right-sided heart failure, and see what monitors can, how the monitors can, advanced monitors can help up, help us for this issue. If we have a left heart failure and we are using advanced hemodynamic monitor, either TEE or pulmonary artery catheter or pulse contour analysis or the combination of the three. On the left side, we have left ventricle end-diastolic area index less than 5. We're expecting it from 6 to 9. Pulmonary artery occlusion pressure less by the pulmonary artery catheter less than 5 millimeter mercury. We're expecting it from 10 to 12. Intrathoracic blood volume index, which is blood inside the thorax, heart, and the chest wall, less than 750. Which is usually from 800 to 1,000. So I'm having a definitely a hypovolemic patient with left-sided heart failure. He needs preload optimization. I will give him volume to achieve my target goals, which are mixed venous oxygen saturation more than 65%, central venous pressure oxygen saturation more than 70%, main arterial pressure more than 65%, cardiac index of 2, CVB 8 to 12 millimeter mercury, and our hemodynamic data we discussed before, and lactate less than 3 millimolar per liter. But if I have a left ventricular end-diastolic area index by the echocardiography between 5 and 7, and pulmonary artery occlusion pressure less than 10, and intrathoracic blood volume index less than 8.5, it is the lower range of normal, it is the lower normal range of volume. So I may benefit from preload optimization and I may benefit from inotropes. So I will try volume challenge and I will use inotropes, dobutamine or phosphodiesterase inhibitors or epinephrine. And sometimes we need norepinephrine with phosphodiesterases or dobutamine. Okay, if I have a left ventricle end-diastolic area index less than 9, between 7 and 9, which is the normal range, it's expected to have a good hemodynamics at this range, and have pulmonary artery occlusion pressure less than 15, and intrathoracic blood volume index less than 1,000 by PICO system, so I should have a good hemodynamics. But if I do not have good hemodynamics, I don't need volume, I need inotropic increase. I will use a combination of epinephrine alone, levosimendan alone, or dobutamine or phosphodiesterase inhibitors. And remember, with the enodilators, many times I need norepinephrine with them. But if I have a left ventricle end-diastolic area index more than 9, or the pulmonary occlusion pressure more than 15, and intrathoracic blood volume index more than 1,000, I'm having hypervolemic patient, so I need a preload reduction. I will use inotrope and enodilators. Either I will use epinephrine plus phosphodiesterase inhibitors or levosimendan, and I do not use vasopressors in this situation because don't want to increase the afterload on this overloaded heart. My goal values are discussed. And by achieving, if I achieve my goal values, I will evaluate my therapy. If I do not achieve, I will optimize my therapies again, or look for surgical correction, or use of intra-aortic balloon, or use of assist devices to correct the left-sided failure. Let us go to the right-sided failure. I will use the advanced hemodynamic monitor. I will use my advanced hemodynamic monitor. I will use the T1 transesophageal or the pulmonary artery catheter. I did not mention anything about the PICO. These are the most valuable things. and the PICO readings will not be valuable if I have discrepancy, major discrepancy between the right and left side. If I'm, my patient is hypovolemic, which means that the pulmonary artery occlusion pressure is higher than the central venous pressure, I will increase the preload. This can be diagnosed by transesophageal echo by finding low right ventricular filling volume or pulmonary artery catheter. However, if I have find that pulmonary artery occlusion pressure is less than the CVV pressure or rapid increase in pulmonary artery occlusion pressure, or I find by transesophageal echocardiography right ventricle dilatation, I will assess the hemodynamics of the patient. Is he hypotensive or is he normotensive? If he is hypotensive, I will add inotropy by catecholamines and enodilators, plus increasing the peripheral vascular resistance okay, so and in pulmonary hypertension, I will use inhaled vasodilators. So my choices will be dobutamine, phosphodiesterases with norepinephrine to maintain a good perfusion pressure. I can add epinephrine to this combination in pulmonary hypertension, inhaled nitric oxide or inhaled prostaglandin. So if I'm hypotensive, I will add an enodilator with vasopressor, and I may add epinephrine to this combination. In normotensive, I will add inotropy plus afterload reduction with vasodilator. So I can use dobutamine or plus or minus phosphodiesterase inhibitor and maybe nitroglycerin, but in pulmonary hypertension also, I will use inhaled vasodilators to decrease the right ventricle afterload. My goal values are the same goal values for hemodynamic optimization. If it's achieved, I will evaluate my therapy. If it's not achieved, I will look for surgical intervention, intra-aortic balloon, and assist device. So this is algorithm how to use transesophageal echo, pulse contour analysis, pulmonary artery catheter to guide my volume and inotropy therapy in critically ill patients. Intra-aortic balloon pump is used post-aortically if I'm having a persistent worsening left low cardiac output syndrome despite treatment with high dose of inotropes and vasoactive substances. ST elevation with new evidence of hypokinesis without an option for surgery or intervention or correction, or problem with the anastomosis that cannot be corrected, inadequate revascularization. If achieved hemodynamic stability by the balloon, I will reevaluate it. If not achieved, I will consider the more aggressive intervention with the assist device. Finally, I will say my conclusion. My conclusion is derived from a study by Vincent et al. In critical care, but it applies to non-cardiac surgery and cardiac surgery and intensive care. Cardiovascular monitoring systems play an important role in optimizing perioperative hemodynamic management. Use of hemodynamic monitoring devices per se does not prove the outcome, but appropriate measurements and interpretation of cardiovascular variables help to guide the therapy interventions, which will finally improve the outcome. Most appropriate systems must be selected for the individual patient. Every patient has his own monitor, his suitable monitor, and this is decision is taken prior to surgery, taking in mind the individual risks of the patient and the procedure. Appropriate interpretation of the information offered by the hemodynamic monitor requires the integration of several variables, and echocardiography is increasingly used as a first tool to identify problems. Although pulmonary artery catheter is decreasing, but it has still a major role in critically ill cardiac surgical patients specifically, not general intensive care patient. And thank you.